Welcome to Plano Police Department's True Crimes with Officer Bianez, a podcast dedicated to learning how criminals select their targets and what you can do to not be a victim. During each program, police officer, crime prevention specialist, and certified speaking professional, Chris Bianez teams up with a safety expert to discover crime trends and how you can protect yourself. Because that's what this podcast is all about, increasing the safety for you, your family, identity, and property. It's Plano Police Department's True Crimes with Officer Bianez. Take it away, Chris.
Detective Tony Vidmar, welcome back.
Chris, it's great to be back, and thank you for having me again.
Okay, so what are we talking about this session?
So we are starting to see a heavy increase in telephone scams that are affecting not only our elderly, but general age abroad.
Well, why would this be important for those that are either viewing or listening to this podcast?
Chris, because every single one of our cases involve a loss of financial means, money, along with your compromise of your Social Security information, account information, all of your personal information that deals with you getting credit, etc. But more so, loss of money.
And I'm guessing that it can vary from a small amount to what?
Well, I'm working cases on one that I'm particularly going to talk about today. It's about a $15,000 loss. I'm working some cases where folks have lost a couple hundred thousand.
Wow. Okay. So do you have a true crime story that you could share with us that affected a resident of Plano?
Absolutely. I sure can. So I was assigned a case where a middle-aged female had made a police report with the Plano Police Department. And she had lost about $15,000 of her own money to a telephone scam. It started with she got a pop-up on her computer while she was paying her bills, and it instructed her that there was a problem with her computer and that she needed to call this number. Well, seeing the pop-up on there, she believed, oh, I have problems. This is from the computer company, or if it's from her actual computer itself telling her that there's a problem. She ends up calling this telephone number and speaking with a male who had a distinct accent, a foreign accent. So she is instructed to give him personal information, her bank information, more detailed information about who she is, dates of birth, etc. She was then instructed to stay on the line where this person told her that he was calling her banking information because there was a problem. And so she believed that she was on the phone, a three-way phone call with her bank, which was Bank of America. They convinced her that she did have a problem with the account and that she owed money. And so believing that somehow she owed money, she was then instructed to go to four different locations, Macy's, Target, Walmart, and I believe Lowe's Home Improvement, and was instructed to get prepaid gift cards and then instructed to give those numbers to satisfy what her problem was. Well, over the course of this, and like I said, with $15,000, she used three different cards to make those purchases, which put her financially responsible for all of that. Once she made those purchases, her bank, because she's the one that made the purchases, her bank would not refund that money. And so she lost every nickel she had.
Oh, terrible. Okay, so I got to ask you this question. Bank America, she believes she's speaking to, who then tells her to go out and get some gift cards to satisfy this. So I want to ask you about tactics. What did they do? How do they successfully extract this money?
It's really high pressure. If you think about it, when they're on the phone, that is their tactic. They are bombarding you with questions and answers. I mean, and it is fast. And so it really gets you to where you're not able to process and really sit down and think for a minute, okay, hey, is this really happening, or should I do this or should I do that? They're constantly telling you, I want you to stay on the phone with me. I want you to do this. I want you to do that. I want you to get into your car. I want you to drive to X to Z to this. And so they're constantly telling you, hey, this is what you need to do. This is what we want. So it does not give you any time to research, to follow up, to make a phone call to your bank or to ask a family friend or ask somebody, research it, go online and say, hey, is this a scam? Because they are on the phone with you and they are pressuring you. So it is, it's all about high pressure. And so that is the crux of the scam itself.
Okay, that's the tactic. Keep you online, absolutely. Keep giving you instructions, keep you moving, give you no time to process. So what do we need to know? What do the listeners need to know to safeguard themselves from this? What should they do if they would find themselves in this situation?
I would say, first off, they need to slow down more so than anything. One thing that if somebody is asking you to give your account information, your personal information over the phone, don't ever do it. If somebody's calling you saying that you owe a bill or you do this, you don't give your credit card information over the phone. You don't respond to that, and especially don't answer numbers that you don't recognize as well. With these pop-ups and talking about that, make sure that your antivirus is up to date. And if you do see problems where there are these pop-ups, unplug your computer from the internet. Take it down to a computer specialist, a computer company that specializes in checking for spyware and stuff like that. Take the time to get that done as well. But more so than anything, do not give your information out over the phone, especially to somebody that you don't know, and verify. So once again, she believes that she's on the phone with Bank of America. Mm-hmm. She could have easily said, I want to call my bank itself, because it's midday, mind you. I want to call my bank and I want to talk to my bank manager or whatever, or I want to get in my car. She's already driving around to go to these places. While I'm on the phone, say, I want to stop in my bank and I want to talk to the bank person and just verify. Mm-hmm. And so, but because she was pressured, she did not want to stop doing what she was doing and try to comply with trying to satisfy what she thought was a debt.
When you shared this story, it seems so silly that Bank America's calling to say, go get a gift card to pay your problem here. Why wouldn't they say, we need you to come in
absolutely.
And take care of this? So yeah. That's a great idea, going to the bank.
Yes.
All right, Tony, another story. I want to hear another phone scam story that affected someone in Plano.
Okay, so I received a report of an elderly couple. These folks are probably in their upper 80s. They had a great-grandchild. They got a phone call. It was about 7-8 o'clock at night from somebody that said, hi, Grandma. And she goes, is this Billy? And he goes, yeah, this is Billy. Hey, I am in jail in Arkansas, and I got into some trouble and I need bond money and I need $5,000. I didn't do what they said I did. I'm in trouble. Can you help me? I need to put you on the phone with the detention person, or which is the detective or a sergeant or somebody. So the next thing you know, now she's on the phone with somebody else who's purporting to be a police officer, mm-hmm. telling her that her great-grandson had been arrested. That they need to satisfy this bond and they need it now. They're instructed to go down to, I think it's a Home Depot, or not Home Depot, I'm sorry, it's a Walmart, and obtain $5,000 in prepaid gift cards. They are not to contact any other family members, and that's where the stick is that the great-grandson said, don't call anybody because I'm embarrassed and I don't want my parents knowing and all of this. Can you please help me? So they end up getting in their vehicle and they drive down, and they spent $5,000 of money that they did not have. That is literally every nickel that they had in their savings to try to go and help who they thought was their great-grandson.
Terrible.
Yeah.
Now this scam, is this like, hey, you've never heard of this before, or is this happening quite often?
You're starting to see this happen more and more and more, especially these telephone scams.
It's so common, it even has a name. What do they call this one?
This one's basically just the...
granny scam?
Granny
scam or yeah. Grandparent scam.
Yeah.
Okay, so Tony, walk us through now so the listeners can... they probably got it already, but just to be sure, let's go through the tactics. What did they do to successfully get this money?
So once again, they're playing on emotions of trying to help somebody that's in jail. The phone call it's very stressful, where the first suspect is upset, I'm scared, I've never been arrested before, I'm in jail, please help me, I don't wanna be here. So it ramps up the emotion of you, of your grandparent or a great grandparent having extreme love for that person. They don't wanna see them suffering and scared, so they wanna immediately help. So there is that where you're really getting it on the hook, is it's emotion. Okay, and then it's moving fast. And all of these scams come down to the exact same thing. It is high pressure, constantly moving, not giving the person on the other end of the phone time to process what's going on.
Yeah,
so it's immediate.
You said something, Tony, too, that I said, oh, that's clever. He said, don't what? He said, don't tell
anybody.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's the same thing. And you will hear on all of these scams, it's the same thing. Hey, don't say nothing to nobody. This is between us, etc. And so they're really keeping you from calling somebody or asking somebody or waking somebody up to try to get extra information. They are prying on you. And really, it is very, very, just very heavy tactics on the telephone. Of prying on people's emotions.
Okay, so now what do we do? How do we avoid this? You get a call like this, we got a grandparent gets this call. Also, it seemed like a little clue. I saw the little twinkle in your eye when they said, hi, Grandma. And then what did she say?
She goes, is this Billy?
Gave him the name.
Ah. Absolutely. And so, yeah, well, yes, this is Billy. It's so
okay, so you get a call and you hear this voice, and a senior citizen gets this call and it says, hi, Grandma, and then what should they say then?
They should say, well, who is this? Uh-huh. And make them give a name.
Okay,
never give up the name, and on the reverse, never announce who you think it is on the phone. You make them explain who it is. Okay, and that's the first step. Okay, and so, and then also.
Okay, let's role play this. So mm-hmm. You're Grandpa, and I say, hi, Grandpa. What would you say?
I say, who is this?
Your grandson.
Which one?
Your oldest one.
Well, I have twins. Which one are you?
Click.
Uh-huh.
Okay, let's say that I said, oh, you know who it is, and I gave you the spiel, and I said, don't call anybody. What would you do?
Okay, I would definitely, that would be a red flag, more so than anything, is that they're telling you not to tell anybody, because you definitely want to find out. It's important to find out and get a ton of information. Okay, so if they are telling you that I'm incarcerated in Arkansas and I'm at XYZ jail, then I'm gonna call that jail and I'm going to specifically talk to somebody from that jail by doing research, going through your phone and getting a telephone number off of the internet or information pages or whatever information that you'd use to get a telephone
not
number.
Not a number they give you.
No,
You're gonna look it up yourself. So great. Anything else you can think of in terms of this thing that they should know not to? Should they call the parents, or is it kind of like when they say don't tell, you probably should check with the parents?
I think so, absolutely, yes. If you're getting a strange phone call at night and somebody is asking for money, okay, automatically, if somebody is saying I'm in peril and I need money, red flag should happen automatically. Because how often do you get phone calls in the middle of the night saying that, hey, I need this or I need that, and it's a little bizarre. And especially they are trying to keep you on the line and not letting you hang up the phone to make a phone call or to check. They are keeping you on that line. So they want you to stop what you're doing at your house. They want you to get dressed, do whatever, get in your car. You're still on the phone with these people as you're driving. They are on the phone with you while you're at your destination, whether it's a supermarket or wherever. They're still staying on the phone with you while you're making the purchase of the card. Now they're asking you to scratch the card off and give that number off. There are so many red flags as that's going, is that they never want to disconnect with you on the phone. And the reason for that is because they want to make sure that you're not asking questions of somebody or being told, hey, don't do this or don't do that. Have you thought about this? They're actually staying on the line just to keep you distracted.
Yeah. If you do follow your advice and if you do slow down and you talk to someone else, the whole scam's going to fall apart.
Absolutely.
It seems you don't like these scammers.
Absolutely.
Taking these nice people's money, do you?
Despise them.
In fact, you told me a story once when a scammer called you.
Yes.
Would you share that with our listeners? What happened?
Okay, so I was working, and I ended up getting a phone call from an unknown number that I had never seen before. The person on the other end has a foreign accent that tells me that I have federal warrants for my arrest because they have flagged my bank account as saying that I am laundering money for drug cartels. And so I said, okay. And so they started asking me pointed questions. They did not know what my bank account was to start with. And so I asked them, I said, well, what bank account are you talking about? Well, which one do you have? I said, I have multiple. And they said, well, which one do you bank with the most? So they were digging to try to get information. So I started to play along, and I said, Chase Bank. I don't bank at Chase Bank, but I said Chase Bank. And they said, okay, well, yes, we see that Chase Bank is on the list as you laundering money. So we want you to go, you have to settle a bond for a potential arrest to stay from being arrested. I was like, okay, we need you to go and get in your car, and we need you to go to these specific locations, and we need you to get prepaid gift cards. Everything is prepaid gift cards, as you can see, and I'll talk later about Bitcoin, but it is get in your car, stay on the phone, don't tell anybody. And as I said, okay, so I am at the office. I said, you know what? I'm going to entertain this. So I went outside, I got in my car and pretended I was driving around and just driving the neighborhoods. And they told me, okay, we need you to go to start with Walmart. Go to Walmart, get $1,000 in gift cards, and give us the number. And then, so I drove around and I said, well, I acted like I went to Walmart. I was in the parking lot and there's hustle and bustle going on. And I acted like there was a problem with the card. Mm-hmm. And I'm on the phone with them. And I said, well, the lady says that my card won't work at the reader. And there's a problem with it. And the person on the phone is getting agitated and said, well, you need to go, you need to leave there and you need to go and find a Target. So I go and I'm driving around and I go to another parking lot. And mind you, we're now about 15 minutes into the conversation. I go to another parking lot and did the same thing. I go in and I act, well, my car's not working. Well, they're telling me this. And they're asking me all kinds of questions. He's, well, you don't answer. And so I told him, I said, well, the card's still not working, this and that. They said, okay, well, now you need to go over to Best Buy. So then I drive over to Best Buy. Now we're at 30 minutes. So I drive over to Best Buy. I did drive over to Best Buy, and I walked in the store, and I'm just kind of milling around. And I told him, I said, no. I said, I think I'm over my limit. Well, they said, well, you need to use another card. And so I said, okay, so I had an old gift card, an old, old one. And so I go back out. I tell him, okay, I got the gift card. He says, oh, I want the numbers off of it. So I read off the numbers, and this is an old, old, old gift card that had no money on it. Huh. And he says, well, there's a problem with the card. And I said, well, this is what they gave me. He goes, well, they forgot to load it. You need to go back in. So I act like I go back in. Mind you, we're now at about 45 minutes on the phone. He is getting so flustered with me, it's not even funny. Well, finally, after I went back in, I said, well, I can't get any more. And then he starts yelling at me that I'm going to get arrested and that he knows now that I'm playing with him, and he hangs up on me.
Oh, so he figured out. He got scammed.
Yes.
Now, why did you take the time to mess with him that way?
So Chris, on the telephone conversation I had with him for that 45 minutes, I saved a legitimate victim from being victimized by these scammers. And so that hour that I took away from him saved possibly somebody in Plano some money.
And you really care about saving people's money, don't you?
Absolutely.
Well, thank you so much for coming today. I was wondering about, you mentioned Bitcoins. Is that something to cover quickly here, or should we? What is the story on Bitcoin?
So it's the exact same thing. You know how we were discussing that you're on the phone and you're being directed to go ahead and go and get prepaid gift cards. Bitcoin now is becoming such a hot commodity to where you start seeing a lot of these Bitcoin ATMs throughout the Dallas Metroplex area. So it acts as basically almost the same thing as those prepaid gift cards. So I'm being instructed, hey, you can pay your federal debt, okay, that you have a debt, a warrant, or whatever, the federal government, or if it was the Plano Police Department, we now accept funds in Bitcoin, which we do not, neither does the federal government. So they're being instructed to go down to these ATMs and use their hard-earned money to buy Bitcoin, and the suspects are giving them what's called a Bitcoin wallet number, and they're to send those funds through Bitcoin. And so with that, once again, that's cryptocurrency. And these scammers use cryptocurrency for a reason, because it's very, very hidden. It's hard to find. So once you send that money, it's gone.
Not going to get it back.
You're not going to get it back.
Let me ask you about these gift cards. How much money were you able to, as a detective, once you heard about a case where someone sent the money on the gift card, how much money were you able to get back for the victim?
Very little. Very little to none. And the reason being is because once you send that code, your scratch-off code for that prepaid gift card, the second that the suspect gets it, they're transferring it immediately. And they do that for a reason, because once you say you buy a Walmart gift card and you put $100 on there, once that person has that number, they will transfer that $100 off to it immediately onto something else. So all Walmart would probably do is just track the initial loading of the card and the transferring of the money. They don't follow it after the transfer of that money. And so these criminals, they're very savvy. They will immediately try to take that money off and then put it into other things.
So when someone wants you to pay some kind of fine, whatever, by gift card, what can we assume?
That it is a 100% scam.
Okay. Well, listen, Detective Tony Vidmar, thank you for joining us today.
It's always my pleasure. Thank you so much.